Not as long as Stephanie's with us. There's no segregation going on.
Know,
she's only on the up and up.
That's why you invited her up.
There's always one in the crowd. That's our friend Nancy Rice.
Making sure this is
thank you for doing this.
RPTG meeting again this September. I'm so happy to be able to do this. This is like old times. Everybody has a seat. We have a very special guest today, Ben Hopkins, who I think many of us know. Certainly Brian knows Ben. This is a student of one of our colleagues who has gone on to do wonderful things in the music world. You don't have programs because Ben has a very special surprise for you. But when you get your programs, his biography is here. I won't read the whole thing. You can read it, you know, at your leisure. He did study with Brian here and went to the University of Southern California. And he holds several degrees from there. He has studied with Corey Ham and Lucinda Gardner, Julia Martin, and of course Brian. He's a two-time prize winner of National Federation of Music Clubs, we all know that, Young Artist Auditions, and won grand prize at the inaugural Silverman Piano Competition. And there are many, many other honors here. And he's a chamber music collaborator and has done extensive chamber music here. Musicians from Rochester Philharmonic, Vancouver, Milwaukee, Cleveland, Texas Quartet, and many others. So, you can read it when you get the program because he has a very special thing about the programs today. May I present Ben Hopkins?
Thank you for having me, Barbara, and Brian for suggesting this. It's really great to be back in Rochester. This is the first time that I've played real in-person audience since before everything. So the program, I'm just going to give you a brief overview of what I'm playing. I'm going to start with a set of bagatelles, and then I have, following that, a set of nocturne, two mazurkas, opus 50, and two etudes, then several excerpts from forest scenes, three American preludes. Give you these programs, we'll kind of pass them out like a piano literature class or something. So, the idea for this program sort of comes out of my doctoral research. And I'm sorry if you were excited about the Schumann forest scenes, because it's not going to be Schumann. And it's not going to be whatever composer you associate with Bagatelles. For me, it's Beethoven. And not a Chopin Nocturne or Mazurkas or anything like that. When I was going through the Clyburn competition archives, I surveyed everything from the competition in 1993 up through seven editions to the most recent one, and found that there were, over that span of time, 39 Liszt sonatas programmed, about 33 Rachmaninoff B-flat sonatas, around the same amount for the Chopin number 2 and number 3, and you can probably imagine Gaspar's Paganini variations. But over that whole course of time, one work by a woman was programmed, and no work by a non-white composer. Which is also kind of interesting because the Clyburn commissions new music as well for the competition. And I also started noticing in my own teaching, when I would get new students coming in, I was in Canada for a while, and they all kind of came up through the RCM system there. And they would all bring their RCM books, and I would hear the same Chopin or Mozart sonata, almost to the point where I could expect exactly what would go wrong in those pieces. So the idea behind this program is to take some of those genres that we all know really well and take your expectations for those titles of pieces and give you something new. There may be a couple things on here that you've heard before, but hopefully most of them are completely new. And some of them I think are very appropriate for teaching intermediate or advanced students. And a lot of them I just enjoy playing. A quick note, I've switched more or less on the program for three excerpts from Samuel Coleridge Taylor's Forest Scenes. So that's the Forest.
Cell phones, Benjamin?
Oh, yes. Please turn your cell phones on or off or whatever. Thank you, Brian. The Bagatelles by Holcomb are nine new Bagatelles, which implies the existence of the old Bagatelles, which were actually a Clyburn commission. They're very witty, droll character pieces, essentially. They're all very descriptive. There are two that have a slightly more detailed explanation. Lord Lovell's Trunk is supposed to depict the story of a young bride with an old husband, and they play hide and seek. She hides in an antique trunk and gets stuck in there, and he never finds her. And Wall's Oubliable is meant to be about memory loss.
Thank you.
next group of pieces I'm going to play are the set, the Nocturne, the Mazurkas, and the Etudes. The Nocturne by Respighi, I think, alludes to Chopin in the opening, where you'll probably get the reference. The Mazurkas by Shostakovich were written between 1924 and 1925. For me, I hear hints of Stravinsky in it. It's more contrapuntal than you might expect for the time. And then the connection between Shostakovich and Batsevich, who was actually a student at the Warsaw Conservatory when Shostakovich was a professor there. She was primarily trained as a violinist and a composer, but apparently also was a pretty good pianist. Her most probably well-known work is her second piano sonata, which Christian Zimmermann is kind of a champion and is a really great piece, actually. But these two etudes, I think sometimes she's referred to as a neoclassical composer, is fairly interesting because they're from 1958, and so at that time it was she's writing still in a kind of older, maybe out of vogue style for that time, and Boulez had already written his three sonatas by that point, I think. So there's quite a range chronologically. It starts from this kind of prototypical romantic work and then just gets weirder.
Thank you.
selections from Samuel Coleridge Taylor's Forest Scenes, Opus 66. This is back to the kind of romantic salon style. The Forest Scenes is in five movements. Just to give you kind of a taste of the two characters who play in this work, it's kind of programmatic. There's a lone forest maiden, and there is a phantom who is also lonely, and they meet, and it's sort of like Shape of Water or something, I guess, because the phantom lover shows up, and they get together. In the third movement, the fourth movement, they go on this horseback ride, kind of, I suppose, cliche for the era, and then they ride into the city and, I guess, live happily ever after. So the first movement is the lone forest maiden, and then the third is the phantom lover arrives and declares his love, and I guess that's kind of the midpoint. So you'll notice these are kind of, Coleridge Taylor was often referred to as the African Mahler, which is just interesting in the context of how we talk about composers who are outside of the mainstream. Joseph de Bologna, who's gotten some attention lately too, or maybe Chevalier. I'm blanking on it, but the Black Mozart, or the, well, I guess the Clara Schumann is the female Schumann, literally. But how we talk about composers in relation to their existence in this white European male framework. And Coleridge Taylor, I think, is a composer who deserves to exist on his own terms. And these are just two great examples of his work.
Thank you.
suppressed or killed by the Nazi regime, and he's also championing works by African American composers in the 20th century that sort of fell out of vogue for whatever reason. And his explanation is that we need to hear these pieces performed multiple times over the course of years so that we have a context for them before we just decide that well, Coleridge Taylor is maybe not for me, or Dawson, or Gideon Klein, but give them a chance to exist in the literature. So that's why I added some Coleridge here. Coleridge Taylor, sorry. The next set of pieces, at UBC, I got very fortunate and was able to commission two pieces for my dissertation and my lecture recital. And I worked with these two composers, I knew them personally. Joel Thompson is currently doing a doctorate at Yale, and when I met him, he had just recently completed a work called Seven Last Words of the Unarmed. And that was the piece that really got me thinking about commissioning and playing music with political or social relevance. The Seven Last Words of the Unarmed, Joel took the last words of seven unarmed black men who were killed in this country and set them to music. So when I asked him to write a couple pieces for my commissioning project, we initially talked about maybe writing another set of prison songs. He's written the volume based on poetry written by prison inmates in this country. But then 2020 and everything that happened there, George Floyd, the Black Lives Matter protests happened, and the pieces that came out of that summer are these three. Toten Tots, Lacrimosa, and the last movement takes its title from L'Armé, which you may remember from way back in music school. The Armed Man, he flips that, recontextualizes it, and the translation is the kneeling man. So it refers to the man who knelt on George Floyd's neck and killed him. This motive, you'll hear a lot, it takes G flat and F to spell George Floyd. And the second movement introduces the name Ahmaud for Ahmaud Arbery, spelled in musical notes as well. So obviously A, B, H. He uses E, takes the M from me. A again. The U comes from Oot, and then D. So you'll hear that. The third movement takes the national anthem, reharmonizes it, and brings all those themes together. And I think represents this tension that Joel feels as a black man between his belief in America and his really complex feelings that came out of 2020. So this is My Dun and Shook, which also, by the way, refers to an essay by James Baldwin. Thank you. Peter Fazio Sayed. And the piece is inspired by a popular song, very popular in Turkey. Interestingly enough, Fazio Say faced criminal charges in Turkey for tweeting some jokes, and was eventually let off the hook as long as he promised not to tweet any more jokes. But I think most of the time he lived in Europe, he has written a sonata, My Dungeon Shook, and I find this connection with the Janáček Sonata, where you know, it's written to sort of protest and musically commemorate state violence. And as I say, also has this, actually a trilogy of pieces called Gezi Park, which the middle work is a sonata that is sort of protesting Turkish military basically coming in and breaking up a protest and violently leading to the deaths of some protesters. So he is also a fairly political composer. All this piece is not political, but it's, I'd say, his most popular work. You'll hear he's kind of imitating the sound of a Turkish lute, known as a saat, in the outer sections of this piece. I'm playing for people again, not just the camera.
I'd like to say a thank you to Ben on behalf of the Guild. It's been a long time since I've heard a recital that I found so moving.
Yeah.
And that is counting pre-2020. I thought it was a thoughtful and evocative program. Thank you so much. And I'd also like to thank Barbara for hosting us. And really, every year I come in thinking, oh, last year was my favorite. And then I come out thinking, oh no, this year is my favorite. Thank you, you outdo yourself. And I think we would love to have a picture with our board and Benjamin up here, if board members would like to come up for our picture, and then we can break for some refreshments, perhaps.